My name is Ameen Haque and I'm going to talk about the power of stories. Stories or storytelling. When you hear these words, most people associate stories with two or three things. The first thing that we tend to associate stories with are children. Now, children love stories and children should be told stories. However, the fact remains that the largest consumers of stories in the world are not children, but adults. We consume stories through fiction. We consume stories as movies, as entertainment, as sport, as news, as religion, as ideology, as politics. Adults consume stories as video games. Adults are the largest consumers of stories. But when we don't associate stories with adults and we associate stories with kids, we fail to recognize the power of stories, and in some ways we undermine and underestimate the power of stories. The second thing that we associate usually stories with is falsehood. Stories are lies, stories are fiction, story is the opposite of fact, but some of the most powerful narratives, some of the most compelling narratives, some of the most compelling, inspiring stories are based on true incidents, are based on real lives. The story of Mahatma Gandhi, the story of Nelson Mandela, the story of Mother Teresa. Sports. The story of Muhammad Ali, the story of Mary Kom, the story of Sachin Tendulkar or of Jeev Milkha Singh. Rags to riches stories, the story of Dhirubhai Ambani or the story of a middle class IT engineer, Narayan Murthy, creating world-class company called Infosys. Real stories inspire change, but when we associate stories only with fiction, we undermine the importance of story and the power of story to inspire us and cause a change in real life. The third thing that we associate stories with is entertainment. And of course, entertainment is storytelling. Stories are at the heart of all good entertainment. But story is much more than that. Stories are wisdom disguised as entertainment. Stories can change your heart. Stories can influence change. Stories can change the course of your life. And when we associate stories only with children, only with entertainment, and only with falsehood, we under-leverage the power of stories. So today I am here to talk to you about the power of stories. Let's start with education. How many of you can come up here on stage right now and explain the Pythagoras theorem? Please raise your hands. Explain. And don't bluff, you know, I'll be calling you. You may want to look around the room right now. This is what we can call a moment of realization. Thank you. How many of you remember the Archimedes principle? Very few. Thank you. Now, how many of you remember the hare and the tortoise? All of you. How many of you remember the thirsty crow? All of you. The monkey and the cap seller? All of you. It's interesting. It's very interesting that stuff, content, concepts that we learned not too long ago, relatively not too long ago, in grade 7th or grade 8th, and we'd not just learnt it, we rehearsed it, we memorized it, we learnt it by heart. Some of us even made chits that we could copy from in exams. Despite all those efforts, we've forgotten that. And stuff that we remember is stuff from much earlier, stuff that we never rehearsed, never memorized, never learned by heart. And that is the power of story. If we want people to remember things, we want them to lock it in their memories, we should tell them stories. But we don't teach in school through stories. Stories can be used to teach math. Stories can be used to teach science. Stories can be used to and should be used to teach history. Rudyard Kipling has said very beautifully that if history were to be taught through stories, it would never be forgotten. What's the point of learning history if all you need to do is remember dates? That's not the point of learning history. We learn history so that we can learn why certain events happened and how they can be prevented from occurring again. Let me take you back to your school days. You will remember, and most of you will agree with me, that there is a very strong correlation between your favorite subject and your favorite teacher. Your favorite subject was taught to you by your favorite teacher. The corollary is also true. The subject you didn't like was taught by a teacher you didn't like. And the subject that you feared the most was taught by a teacher you disliked the most. It's the teacher who makes a subject interesting. And if the teacher can be a storyteller, then the teacher can make any subject interesting. Why should we use stories in the classroom? Because stories speak to the imagination. What do I mean by that? Let me illustrate through a story. Once upon a time, there was a boy called Rahul who lived in a house with his parents, mom, dad, and with a sibling, his elder sister, at the end of a village. And next to that village was a forest that was very large, very dense, and most of the villagers never ventured into the forest because they had heard stories about ferocious animals in that forest. One day, this little boy Rahul has an argument with his father and the mother, and in his childish anger, he stomps his feet and starts walking in anger towards the forest. As he goes deeper and deeper into that forest, now he's never been into that forest before, but today, as he goes deeper and deeper into that forest, the forest gets denser and denser, and he starts encountering birds and animals that are increasingly more and more ferocious. I'll stop here. The boy Rahul that you saw in your imagination, the clothes he was wearing, how old he was, is different from the boy you saw. And the forest in your imagination is different from the forest in your imagination. And the birds and animals that you saw are different from the birds and animals you saw in the story. Because when I am telling you a story, I am not the only one who's working. Your imagination is working with me. You are not passive listeners to an oral story. You are actively engaged and you are imagining and completing the story. Story speaks to the imagination. If the same story was told through television, then all of you would have seen the same Rahul, and all of you would have seen the same forest, and all of you would have seen the same birds and animals. Oral storytelling speaks to the imagination. Yet we don't use it in the classrooms. Why is it that we don't use stories in the classrooms? Because teachers are not trained in storytelling. Teachers are trained to teach through rote learning. So we need to overhaul our B.Ed. education system. We need to overhaul the Montessori education system if we need to bring about a change in the education system. And we must revolutionize and change the education system, because it's a crime, it's a pity that we teach children through rote learning by mugging up. Instead, they should be learning through stories, so that the next time when we ask somebody a question, what's the Pythagoras theorem, everybody remembers it. Let me talk about entertainment. We think of movies as entertainment. We think of movies, our idea of movies is the idea of having a good time, of escaping reality, of going into a movie hall and having a good time. Now, I'll tell you the story of a friend of mine. This friend of mine was an engineer from Bits Pilani. He finished his engineering and went to the US to do his master's. He stayed back in the US and worked in a technology company as a scientist. He came back to India, married his girlfriend, went back there, settled there, had a child there. Since the child was born in the US, the child was a US citizen. One day he went to see a movie. The movie was Swadesh, a 2004 blockbuster featuring Shah Rukh Khan in the role of Mohan Bhargava. Now, in this movie, Shah Rukh Khan plays the character of a NASA scientist, and he comes back to India to search for his nanny, Kaveri Amma, and to take back Kaveri Amma to the United States. But what happens in the story is that the development in US is contrasted with the underdevelopment in India. The comfort in the US is contrasted with the challenges in India. And everything that runs on autopilot in US is contrasted with struggles for every small thing like electricity, like water in India. And so moved is Shah Rukh Khan by the plight that he decides to quit and comes back to India to usher in a change. My friend, who was sitting there in that audience, he was sitting there in that hall that day, he cried and he had tears in his eyes. And he resigned. He quit his job and he came back to India. Today, he's an entrepreneur. He lives in Bangalore. And I know five other people who have moved back after watching that movie. Stories are not just entertainment. They are not just escape from reality. They touch your heart and they can change the course of your life. Leaving a job, leaving a dollar salary, coming back to India without having a job is not an easy decision. I'll give you another example. Many years ago, there was a movie which was remade in Hindi from a Telugu film. It had Anil Kapoor in it. It was in the 1980s and the theme was widow remarriage. It was taboo then. It's still a taboo now in India. The movie was called Ishwar. And in that movie, Anil Kapoor defies society and societal conventions and goes against the wishes of his parents and all his friends and well-wishers to marry a widow. I know somebody who lives in Jharkhand who saw that movie and was so inspired by that movie that he told his father that I will not marry. If you want me to marry, find me a widow. He married a widow with a child 20 years ago. And they are still married. A story can change the course of your life. It's much more than entertainment. And if we understand the power of story, then we can use it, we can engage with it to usher in change. The world needs change. The world needs tolerance. The world needs peace. We keep talking about the change the world needs, but we keep looking for devices and levers that can bring about change. Here's a device that's staring us in the face. We don't engage with it enough because we don't understand it. We are just about beginning to understand the power of story. Now, let me talk about business. We think business is all about numbers. We don't remember numbers. We don't remember facts and figures. Facts and figures don't persuade us. We don't remember yesterday's newspaper headline. We don't remember our friend's Facebook page update from yesterday. We remember stories. And a businessman, a CEO, a leader, an entrepreneur needs to tell stories, because what is entrepreneurship if it is not autobiographical? What is leadership if it is not autobiographical? Let me give an example. You are an entrepreneur. Imagine you are an entrepreneur. You've come up with an idea. You are excited about that idea. You are seeing the possibilities of this idea. You have sat in a time machine and you have traveled in that time machine to 5 years from now or 10 years from now, and you can see that your products and services are making money. They are making the world a better place. Consumers are loving your products and services. Your employees are happy. Your investors are richer. And your partners and vendors are very happy. You have seen this, but they haven't. And no general can win a war alone. You need an army of believers to make this dream a possibility. That possibility, that vision can be made real if you can convince employees to leave other organizations and join yours. If you can convince an investor to back your business. If you can convince partners and vendors to work with you. Otherwise, your vision will remain just that, a vision. An entrepreneur needs to be a storyteller. An investor wants to know two kinds of stories. Investors tell entrepreneurs, excite me about the business potential of your idea, number one, and excite me about you, the businessman. Most entrepreneurs can't tell these stories clearly enough, fast enough. That's called an elevator pitch. And that's why we need to teach storytelling in MBA institutes. We need to teach storytelling in entrepreneurship courses. But we don't teach that enough. Business is changing and business needs are changing. Let me illustrate to you that through a story. A long time ago, there was a salesman. He used to sell television sets, and this was still those days when televisions were new and the idea of televisions was new. He would go from place to place selling them the idea of televisions and selling them televisions. One day he reached a village where he saw that all the villagers, after their work was over in the evening, would gather and sit around a fire and they would tell each other stories. And he told them, you guys love stories, you guys would love televisions because here's a box that can tell you stories. So all villagers said, yes, we love stories. And all the villagers bought a TV each. He was very happy with the sale that he made. He moved on. After 3 or 4 months, when he was passing by, he happened to see that all the televisions that he had sold to the villagers were stacked on top of each other and were gathering dust. He asked the villagers, what happened? I thought you guys loved stories. The villagers said, of course we love stories. But this TV, it just tells us stories. It doesn't listen to our stories. Today, the world of business is changing. For the last 50 years, business has been telling stories through advertising. It has been telling stories to employees, to stakeholders, to partners, to media, to vendors. But today, customers are in control of the narrative on social media. Today, employees are in control of the narrative. And business doesn't know how to deal with this because they aren't trained to listen to stories and to co-create the narrative along with customers, along with employees, along with partners, along with stakeholders. Facts don't persuade. Facts are not even remembered. Stories get remembered. So let me tell you this story very quickly. Once upon a time, a long time ago, there was this old man and he had this interesting coat or a jacket with a lot of pockets in it. And wherever he went, people welcomed him and they said, old man, come here and spend some time with us. And old man would sit with them and have tea and coffee. Everybody loved to spend time with old man. And old man would spend time with everyone. At the same time in the world, there lived a woman. Wherever the woman would go, people would shut their doors and windows. She was naturally upset. She goes to the old man and says, why is it that wherever you go, you are welcomed, but wherever I go, I am turned away? Who are you? And the old man smiled and shrugged his shoulders and said, I am story. Who are you? And the woman said, I am truth. You see, nobody likes the truth, but the old man had the wisdom to realize that the world needs the truth. So the old man said, there is much more hospitality than I need for myself. Why don't you come along with me and I can share all the goodies with you? And the world needs the truth. Maybe it just doesn't like the form in which it is presented. So truth jumped into story's pocket. And from that day it is said, wherever story goes, you can find truth. So I invite you and I encourage you. I invite you and I encourage you to start telling stories. Like Ira Glass had said, that great stories happen to those who can tell them. When you start telling your stories, who knows where your story may take you. Thank you.